you're all doing well. My name is Heather for some of the people who just came in. And I work with the Somerville Arts Council, and this is a collaboration with Somerville Open Studios. And this is Gina, this year's coordinator of SOS 16. So this is in conjunction of SOS's last Wednesdays, and Gina's going to talk a little bit about that.
Well, I'd actually love if either Nancy or Johanna, if you guys want to come up and give a little bit of the spiel about, also because I'm getting over a cold, but also they are the like masterminds behind Last Wednesday, so I don't know if either of you would like to come up and just give a little bit of the briefing on that.
So SOS, for those of you who don't know, is Somerville Open Studios, and we have a big weekend coming up, the very end of April. We'll have a trolley going around to all the studios around here, and Gina will talk more about that. Nancy Anderson and I we put together a last Wednesday. So every last Wednesday of every month, it's sort of a social club for artists. You don't have to be a member of SOS to do it. Just a Somerville artist, and the idea is that every other month we get together and try to do a studio crawl of other fellow artists within Somerville, just to see what people are working on and have a conversation, because we kind of usually do that on SOS weekend. We have to be in our own space. And then we also have months where we do kind of a salon-style conversation about different aspects of being an artist and things that concern us or that we're interested in. And we also are organizing some workshops and skill shares for this summer months, where people will be demonstrating or showing people how to actually, what they work on and how it's done. So we have a sign-up sheet over there. If you'd like to sign up, I have some flyers over there you can take right under that weird green light. So please do that.
And like our Facebook page.
Yes, we have a Facebook page.
Last Wednesday.
Yeah. Thanks.
Cool. Thank you, guys.
So just a couple housekeeping things before we get started. We would love to do this again. So this isn't like the only marketing thing that we were, want to do. So there's a little sheet after this event, if you want to just jot down if there's something that we've missed, or there's something that you would like to see that we didn't do, or there's something aspects that you find work well for you. We would love to hear about it, so you can jot them down on that sheet. And also, there's takeaways at the tables, different marketing 101 tips, sample press releases, and sample master media lists, and different things about Instagram. And lastly, after the event, there's going to be a breakout session, so you can talk to each other, talk to the speakers, and also share your tips of what works best for you with your other fellow artists.
Cool. Yes. Yeah. I mean, as mentioned, I'll do a little plug in the beginning, because I'd be remiss if I didn't, just about Open Studios and kind of what's coming up this month. April is kind of our big month for Open Studios, so if you're coming here through our listserv, you're probably pretty well aware. I've been sending out all the, most important dates, but April 29th is our sneak preview night. That's the Friday before, and then April 30th and May 1st, those are our big days. So that's SOS weekend. And if you're participating, awesome, and hopefully you'll learn a lot tonight to help you market and get more people to come see you that weekend. And if you're not participating, then come out and enjoy it. Maybe when we have our breakouts, you'll talk to people who are going to be open that weekend, and you'll learn more about it from them. But I just encourage, if you have any questions, want to learn anything else, SomervilleOpenStudios.org is the website to learn more about. You can talk to me. You talk to probably half the people in this room are, experts in their own right if they're presenting. So, I think that's kind of it for Open Studios.
Well, without any further ado, we would like to present the two speakers for this evening. We have Megan Ackerman, who is a social media guru for the city of Somerville. And then we have David Thompson, who is launching his own startup called Artily. And both of them are going to tell you about themselves and what they do, and ways that you can effectively market yourself and your art. So take it away.
So, going to be up here kind of doing the moderating light just to keep us on track. If there are questions, help them bring those in. But yeah, come on up here. We're going to have both people start. You can choose between the two of you which one would like to go first. But just kind of a brief intro about themselves, what you guys consider to be your you know, best skill sets and what you bring to the table.
So as Heather said, my name is Megan Ackerman. I work for the city doing, among other things, social media, creating content and helping to manage some of the other accounts that I don't create content for.
I'm sorry, can you speak up?
Sure. All right, I'll do my best. I'm not always super loud, so I apologize in advance. So in terms of sort of strengths, even before I was doing this job, I was just on social media all the time anyway. I loved it. I was sort of in the right place at the right time. I was a college student in Boston while Mark Zuckerberg was starting Facebook, so got to be one of those lucky people who was on it like super early, as soon as it opened up outside of Harvard. I don't know if anyone else here at the time was going to school in Boston, but it was Facebook was very small and you had to have like a college address and all this other crazy stuff. And since then I've just been using different social media just in my private life, and I've been lucky enough to kind of turn it into a job, which is super fun.
Cool. My name is David Thompson. I just moved back here from San Francisco actually, and I am sort of more of a Boston native, I would say. I went to high school here, college here at Tufts, and returned to do this startup called Artlery, A-R-T-L-E-R-Y. And basically we are essentially at the core an artist rights management platform. One of the things that we're working very hard to support is something called second sale royalties. So also known as droit de suite or artist resale rights, goes by different names. What that really means is that as your pieces get resold, we track all the rights, the secondary rights, residual rights that you as an artist are owed. And so the core of that is a financial platform. So we allow you as an artist to sell art directly on our platform and receive a credit card, almost like a Square for artists. If you're in your studio, you could have your art on the app, receive a credit card payment, and it'll go right to your bank account. We're also opening our own essentially gallery. It's an art space, we call it, in downtown Boston, the financial district. And the name of it is @ Artlery160, which is kind of a play on the social media, which correlates to our Instagram and our Facebook and Twitter and Pinterest and all that. And so we're using it just as a way to explore, you know, kind of where the art world is now. We have the first artist is actually from Vernon Street Studios in Somerville. His name's Ara Azad. He's a museum school artist. And the opening's April 11th. You're certainly all welcome. It's at 160 Federal Street. It's a beautiful historic Art Deco building. So the idea is really bring the art to the kind of the business world, if you will, kind of right in their workspace. And we have a very interesting model, which we're experimenting with. The whole thing is quite experimental, but the model works whereby we, as us as a gallery, we actually only take 30% of the transaction, 50% goes to the artist, and then 20% we give away to the public. And so basically anybody who comes and visits the art, whether they purchase it or not, we will apportion the 20% and divvy it up amongst the patrons or people from the community. When the art sells, we actually track the distance they were from the art as a proxy. So if somebody's in India or China and they appreciate the art, it's worth a lot less than somebody who visits. And when it sells, we pay out to the public, and they have a choice. They get an email that says this piece of art is sold. You can either collect your cash, you can invest it back into the artist's career, or if you do nothing, it'll go to charity. So we're really trying to pursue kind of a full circle type of transaction and really make, you know, art sort of a holistic transaction from the get-go. So that's what we're doing, and you know, we're definitely looking for artists to show at our space at Artlery 160 in lost it.
Can you say that louder?
Oh.
That's right, like it's getting lost.
Sorry. Which part?
Didn't even look
out. Oh, sorry. It's called @@artlery160. So if you go to artlery.
What?
Artlery, A-R-T, L as in Larry, E-R-Y, and then the number 160. If you go to artlery.com, you'll see that. The name, in case it is a little bit hard to say, but the name actually comes from, it's a financial instrument that's backed by art, is really where the name comes from. So it's not a security, it's not a property, it's not a commodity. We're really trying to push this notion of art less as a transactional object to be bought and sold, and much more of a relational asset to be owned and interacted with by the community.
So, just to get the pulse in the room, are people still having a hard time hearing? Should we course correct? Okay. I'm wondering if you guys don't mind if we stand.
Sure.
Yeah.
I'm curious to know, in all mediums of art and all price points, when you're representing artists, what artists are you representing, or is that kind of the framework right now?
Yeah, we're really trying to figure out as we go along. But one of the things we're trying to do, we have this notion, we're tracking all the statistics. So we show, when we finish an exhibition for an artist, we'll be able to show all of the interactions and touch points that we, all the different people that have visited. We actually have special sensors that we associate with each piece of art. I can show people later. But basically, we actually track the amount of time people spend around the art. We track the number of people that are congregating around each piece of art. And so we're tracking all this analytics and all this data. And we present that back to the artists at the end of the exhibition to say, hey, we weren't just sitting around behind the desk, doing whatever. We were actually, showing all these people. And we had all this engagement and all this excitement around your art. There were having all these conversations. So to answer your question, we're trying as a platform. The core platform is non-curatorial, so we really don't discriminate. We have very granular privacy and security settings. You can control. You can either have it totally private, only share it based on people having to be in the proximity. So it'll only show up in our app if people are there. We have a security model that only shows up if you're in the city, or you can make it public. So we're really trying to make it, give it to the artist and let them control how they want their art to be.
So in the world of art, there's fine painting, there's ceramics, there's weaving, there's so
yeah.
Many,
our platform is totally agnostic. We have all sorts of, we just crossed $1.5 million worth of art. It's all sorts of stuff. We have a MIT guy built a Bitcoin ring that just is in the Smithsonian. We have sculptures, we have fine art, we have photographs, digital videos. So the platform's pretty open, but we're still kind of, we're still, it's still very early too. I mean, we're learning as we go and supporting other, each type of art has kind of implicit use cases associated with it, I guess is the bottom line. We don't have support currently for editions, for example. Something that people have asked for, but we don't currently support it.
Is this a service you pay for?
No, we don't charge artists. We don't charge artists. We are we're looking into it sounds horrible, but we have investors, so we're not as worried about making money. We're just worried about how do we provide value, particularly to artists. And as we go on, we would actually, if we had it our way, we would much rather participate in the secondary markets. We'd rather say, let's build a huge pipeline of, let's help artists use our tool to develop their career. And if and when they go way up in value, maybe then we would start to take a smaller piece of a much bigger pie instead of a bigger piece of people that are just trying to pay rent.
So if there are specific questions about the app, maybe we can save those for the breakout time and we'll get into some of the questions. I want to encourage questions though, so don't feel like that's me shutting down question time. But just to kind of take us out, take a look at the kind of basics, one of the first questions that we'd already started talking about a little bit before, but what's core? Like, what are the key things that you guys think, if people aren't doing already or aren't aware of, this is like step number one? So I don't know who would like to jump in first.
So I think the most important thing, if you're starting from scratch or if you're just kind of even looking at what you're doing, is think about what your needs are and what you're trying to accomplish. So, if you are someone doing a lot of photography, visual arts, a platform like Instagram or Blogger might be good for you because they're very image heavy. I don't usually talk too much about specific platforms, although I'm happy to, just because stuff changes pretty quickly. So I think it's important to kind of learn sort of the basic functions and be thinking about, your social media approach that way. So like, what do I need? What kind of content am I going to be sharing? Do I want to have a platform I can make sales on, or is this strictly for networking? Am I going to be showing, or is it, do I need to be sharing video, sound? All of that's going to kind of depend on what platform you go with. That being said, I think the three big ones are Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And then, there are also kind of different tools you can use to help manage them, but we can get into more of that later.
Yeah, I totally echo that. It does seem like Instagram in particular has kind of taken off as a very powerful tool for artists. Pinterest perhaps as well. I think in general there's a interesting correlation or inverse correlation between exposure and value and exclusivity and value. I think often it's sort of how you do it and who's doing it. If somebody is saying you're great, it's way better than you saying you're great, first of all. I think also each platform has its own idiosyncrasies and communities and conventions and things like that. There are ways to use them to be effective, whether you quote or retweet or how you reblog or how you repost somebody else's image and attribute. Those are all things that it does take an investment. It's an investment to kind of figure out how to use them effectively. I will say, selling art online, as an interesting anecdote, we talked with, as just a data point, we've been talking with SF MoMA artist studios in San Francisco early on. They did a trial with Amazon where they took 2,000 pretty well-known, pretty good artists, or pretty well-established artists anyway, and they put them all online on Amazon as a trial for a year. And believe it or not, over the course of an entire year, they sold exactly zero pieces of art. Now, I think it's hard to sell nothing on Amazon. It's pretty hard to do. But what that shows to me is that how you're represented online, how you're representing yourself online is really important. Maybe Amazon doesn't feel like something you go and buy higher-end art. It might work great for prints or, art.com does, sell a lot of, prints online. But if you're trying to sell your own pieces and you're trying to worry about getting a higher price point, sometimes by establishing yourself that way, and that's where your infrastructure is, it'll make it a little bit harder to kind of set selling things at a higher price point once you've established a certain price point. Not impossible, but.
Just to get a feeling in the room, how many people here are on one of those, 3 to 4 social networking sites that was mentioned? Is anyone cruising on all 3 or all 4? Okay, so a few people. So you guys might be the ones that people during breakouts we can chat with how you might be, doing all of those together, but yeah.
So yesterday there was a big thing happened in social media, which is that Instagram was supposed to change their algorithm, and there was this whole kind of upset, and a lot of people have jumped ship to Elo. What do you know about Elo?
In terms of the algorithm, so Facebook changes their algorithm all the time, every couple of weeks, pretty much. That is something just in general to be aware of, when you're using any platform, sort of how what they do might affect, if you're showing up, who's seeing you, how many people are seeing you. I signed up for Elo probably a year and a half ago when it first came out and it was going to be the next Facebook. I have not signed into it in 11 months. you know, one of the things is, you know, I can see, especially for artists, because it's a much more visual platform, there may be some advantages there, but if no one's using it, is it really where you want to be spending your time and energy? You know, all of these different platforms take some time to kind of just learn how to use them, learn, like David said, you know, each platform kind of has its own community, it's a little idiosyncrasies, it's etiquette. So, you know, you definitely want to be looking at too, I think, is there an audience there? Or are you going to have to really work to pull an audience to that site?
Yeah. I had heard of Ello.
Is it
E-L-L-O? I think it's E-A. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's like hello without the H.
Yeah. Yeah, I think generally they're, like with any, there's a local company called HubSpot that invented or pioneered something they call inbound marketing. And one of the things that they talk about is in terms of multiple different channels. And I think if you kind of try to do them all, right, you're gonna spread yourself too thin. I think depending on what you're trying to do, if you're trying to, you know, you try to figure out what you're measuring, what your goals and objectives are, and then you kind of almost see which platform helps you accomplish those goals and objectives. But I think just going there and just putting yourself out there and, you know, shotgun approach and spaghetti approach and seeing what sticks, I don't necessarily think that's the right thing. I think if, you know, there is death by exposure, right? I mean, I think we hear a lot of artists and you know, talk about that. And I think if, you know, for example, if you want to see a really effective use of Instagram in particular, there's a gallery in London called Unit London, I think it is, if you just Google it. And they have 250,000 followers on Instagram for fine art, which is pretty, you know, that's pretty unique. And one of the things that they do, if you look in the way in which they use Instagram, they're always posting just the art, right? It's just art, high quality art. It's not like, you know, pictures of them, you know, I don't know, in the gallery or stuff like that. So that was very intentional, right? They created a certain aesthetic. There's a common aesthetic on what they're doing. There's a certain cadence to it. And for them, you know, it was, you know, they had a very specific purpose in mind. They also run their own physical in-person gallery. And what they use Instagram for is to kind of find out who has the most likes or favorites as a way of selecting the artists to then show at their gallery. So that was a very intentionally constructed use of the tool. It wasn't just, hey, we're gonna put a lot of stuff on Instagram.
Okay, so it sounds like you're kind of already leading into another question that we have on the docket, which is best practices. So you've already mentioned a few things like intentional kind of vision, cadence being two things with Instagram. Can you guys name any others or, you know, help start a discussion about what are those best practices? We can start with Instagram and maybe jump around if people want to ask about different platforms, or if you have any best practices of your own, maybe you would raise your hand, share those too. So,
does everyone know what I mean if I say hashtag? Okay.
No?
Okay. So hashtag, if you are online, you'll see something written and has kind of the pound sign in front of it. That's called a hashtag, and it's essentially a way of sort of cataloging information, because on various social media platforms, you know, say if I'm on Instagram and there's hashtag cats of Instagram, I click on that and it's going to bring me up all these pictures of cats of Instagram. So it's really useful for people who are looking for specific things or, you know, so...
Keywords.
Yeah, keywords, kind of, and it helps with searches, it helps classify things. So a really good thing to do is kind of look at the hashtags folks are using who are maybe doing similar things to you, or folks who are in sort of the community that you want to reach. And I'm guessing for sort of every different type of art, and there are going to be kind of different ones, so... You know, seeking out people who are already doing it is a great way to just kind of watch, you know, what they do, how, what hashtags are they using? Who are they following? Who are they sharing from? Who's sharing them? Kind of keys you into some of the big players in like whatever area it is that you're involved in. I think another big thing, kind of regardless of the platform you use, is don't make it just a vehicle to push out information. Obviously you're there, you're sharing your work, you're promoting your shows and events, but try to be responsive too. If someone leaves a comment, comes and asks you a question about something, it's become something that I think people expect from social media that,
this guy's a chai latte.
Oh.
Somebody, so I'm just asking.
Sorry. That's a very fun
announcement. That was, thank you.
We're talking about conversation.
Oh, conversation. Yeah. I was conversing about conversation.
Yeah.
And that's a good way too to sort of engage your fans and keep them coming back and looking at your stuff and feeling like, okay, if I ask this person a question, if I'm interested in one of their pieces, they're going to be responsive to me. And, someone who's making an investment, especially if it's, a decent amount of money, they want to feel some of that customer service too.
Yeah. I think it's one thing is looking at people who are successful on one of these platforms and look what they do. Like, as I said, I think the name of that that gallery is, I think their Instagram is Paint Guide, in case you want. So we're blatantly looking at how they're, it's called Paint Guide, I think, on Instagram. So since Paint Guide.
Yeah. Paint Guide.
Sorry. Paint
that
guide.
Might be something too.
It probably is something. Yeah.
Do not search that hashtag. You will probably not be happy.
It's contagious. Yeah.
And so as we are starting our own gallery and we're blatantly looking to see what they're doing and how they're doing it and why they're successful. I mean, mimicking or, borrowing, there are different, certain things that are good about their strategy. So I think that's one thing. I think, also giving back, being participatory. Definitely people lurk on these platforms. They just kind of, read the stuff, but I think more you join the conversation, as they say. I think there are little things like in Twitter, people start to notice, like, if they follow you and you don't follow them back, sometimes they unfollow you because they get, offended, or sometimes they look and if you've followed 200 people and only 3 people are following you, or if the ratio is way out of whack. So, kind of ease into it, really focus on interactions and kind of getting your ratio close. I mean, these are kind of high school like things, but it's what people look at.
Oh, I did want to mention people misuse hashtags all the time, and you'll see people do funny things with hashtags. It's like, oh, I don't like hashtag, I don't know what I would do without coffee. So unless someone else is using that hashtag,
it's not necessarily useful.
If you're doing it as a joke, that's fine. But if you really want a hashtag to be useful, other people have to be using it. Like they said, it's a cataloging, it's a keyword, but it's also a conversation. So if you're doing hashtag art, hashtag Somerville, hashtag painter, hashtag whatever, that you're going to be able to get the momentum to be able to get people to respond to whatever you're posting. So like they said, search out what hashtags are going to be useful and what are kind of most popular and most applicable to what you're trying to like.
I think especially with art, more so than a lot of different other types of industries, shall we say, that would use social media, I think quality over quantity is especially important. You can get a ton of likes on Facebook. You can buy likes on Facebook. You can buy an Instagram account preloaded with 20,000 followers. It'll probably cost you $1,000 or something. That doesn't mean that those are going to be valuable to you. They have these link farms and like farms and favorite farms, these kind of ways to automate all this. Politicians do it all the time because they want to look like they're, But that doesn't mean, is that going to correlate to people coming in, quality people that you want to come into your studio? Maybe not. So I think, you know, really focusing on quality, focusing on local, you know, in a lot of instances, building a community around, you know, those types of things. I think usually you can tell in Twitter or otherwise, you can see sometimes where they're located. So maybe you want to have a bias towards following those types of people if you're really interested in starting your career and you want people to come visit your studio in person. Again, that's sort of, if that's your eventual goal, you can use social media in a specific way rather than just getting really excited about having lots of followers.
Yeah, most, just to piggyback on that, most tools have ways that you can search people by location or interests, you know, keywords in their bio. So that's a great way to kind of start looking. So, you know, finding folks in Somerville who are interested in art, following them and, you know, hoping and getting them to follow you back is probably more valuable than having 10 people in Montreal follow you who are never going to be in Somerville to buy one of your paintings. Or
I've seen a couple of hands raised.
Is there a limit on how many categories you can use for an image?
No. For hashtags?
Yeah.
No. And it's kind of interesting, though. There are, by platform, they found different amounts give you different amounts of success. So on Instagram, it kind of seems like, you know, go nuts. If you use a lot or a couple of really well-chosen ones, that doesn't seem to have much of an effect. But on platforms like Twitter and Facebook, people have found a lot, if you overload a post with hashtags, it tends to not do as well. I think, you know.
I guess maybe I should be asking, how many is enough?
I mean,
on Twitter,
you've got 140 characters.
Right.
That's going to, and that kind of gets that. So.
Right, yeah. So something like Twitter, I mean, they do cut you off at 140 characters. Facebook, it's probably better to go fewer just because, you know, for whatever reason, different studies have shown that that just works better for Facebook. Instagram, you know, kind of go nuts with. And the other thing, and it can be a little frustrating at first, some of it you just kind of have to play around with too, because it's all going to vary a little bit by your audience as well. So, you know, some of the, like Facebook, Twitter is getting a little better about their analytics, but Facebook especially has some really good analytics if you set up a business or fan page. So you can just kind of look and see what kind of posts are attracting a lot of people. So, you know, if you put up a post that has a lot of hashtags and it actually got a lot of attention, maybe that's okay for your audience.
I think that's a good message to amplify, is kind of testing and trying yeah. out things and see what works for you. Because it could really depend if you're asking about, like, the specificity, like, should I say Massachusetts? Should I say Somerville? Should I say Davis Square? Should I say Highland Ave? It's, you know, I would say definitely try those things out and see, like, if you start attracting people, if it's an important message to be more granular, is it important to, like, just kind of cast a wider net? I would say always try, and things are always changing, kind of like what we had said earlier. So it's always a good practice to try new things, try new hashtags.
Do you have a copyright question? Because there was a lot of talk to Facebook owning your photos when you post them. What is the deal with Instagram? If you post a photo of your artwork, can Instagram claim to own your photo?
Did everyone hear that question? Okay, great.
So I'm not a copyright expert, although we do know some. I can certainly follow up around that. I think it's really important. Generally speaking, artists, even if you sell your painting, you own the likeness to it of your images. Art is, you know, kind of not, you know, a little bit different that way. I don't know. I think Facebook can't claim to restrict you from doing other things, but you can't stop them from using it, right? So you want to read their terms of service. And this happened with Flickr. I don't know if people heard about this, but I think Flickr, and again, I would have to look back at all the context, but Flickr basically by default said these are in a Creative Commons license, which is great, but then they turned around and started, you know, utilizing them for commercial purposes, and they didn't include the artist at all, and something the artist could do, or the photographer, or whatever, they couldn't do anything about it, and then Flickr was making money off of it, and they weren't paying any, not only were they not paying anything to the artist, but the artist couldn't have any control over how those images were utilized. So you do have to be very, very important. It might seem like a, what is it called, a Faustian bargain, I don't know, what, you know, some sort of, you know, it's all great because you're getting additional exposure, but what are you getting back, right? If it's just followers, again, are those helpful? You're not also getting analytics, right? So if you have your own website, you can see Google Analytics at least shows you where your visitor's coming from, you know, what location. You can segment and track the type of stuff on Instagram. You just don't have that. So you do have to be really careful in terms of what's...
Do you want to market? I was going to say, that's one thing, you know, I know a lot of photographers have been doing for a long time, and it, you know, may be a good idea, especially if it's something that you really kind of want to keep other people from sharing and using, putting a nice big watermark across that image is one way to give you some amount of protection.
Yeah, and that's something, you know, we're looking into as well, you know, very, very avidly, given that, you know, the heart of what we're doing, we're really trying to create sort of like a 360 degree view of your image, where all the different places it is, different media, you know, where is it being used, what locations it's been. So we're definitely going to explore watermarks in particular.
Are there some other hands in the
room? Okay. I'm not on Twitter yet, and the reason why I'm not is I keep thinking, since it's not images, how will I use that for my art? Is that something that I want to waste my time on? You know.
Good question.
Like somebody, yeah. You know, someone said to me, "Oh, you have to be on LinkedIn," and that felt like.
Yeah. Right. So. It might be so. Yeah, that's a tough one because it does take a while. Twitter, in particular, takes an investment just to figure it out, and then it's hard to know, like, you know, after two tweets, if you're going to get a lot of value out of it as an artist. I would maybe look at and see what other people are doing, you know, talk to other people.
Maybe we can open it up to anyone here. Does anyone find a lot of value in Twitter?
You can upload images now, so that is, they have added that, images and video.
Yeah, they've gotten better.
So that's gotten a little bit better.
So you can auto-post back to Twitter as well, from Facebook or wherever else, so.
Yeah, you can link your accounts together.
Exactly, yeah.
Heather, did you have?
Yeah, the one of, you know, like you said, you can link the accounts, you can set up a Twitter account, and you can link it to your page. One thing to keep in mind with when that happens, and the person who has a really good example is the Facebook page is Boston Artists and Opportunities. Rebecca Trueblood is the one that moderates that. She is a great resource for artists in general, just for opportunities. She specifically has her posts designed because she knows it's going to Twitter. So her posts are very short, if you notice, and she has truncated URLs for different things that she's posting. So she's very mindful that her posts are going to be going to her Twitter account. And that's a way of doing double duty, so she's not posting on Twitter as well. So she'll do her hashtag, she'll do whatever URL, and that's going to be going directly to her Twitter account.
What do you get from Twitter as an artist? That's my issue.
A lot of media is on Twitter. A lot of bloggers are on Twitter. So, and I think that's kind of the benefit, that's how they get their news. So the more people that you become, you can follow galleries, you can follow art bloggers, you can follow art journalists, and they can show what's different. So they may not go to your Facebook page, they may not be Facebook friends with you, but when you're utilizing the hashtag, and also URL, they're like, oh, here's that artist. That's the way to use hashtag effectively, because they may be searching out art or art stories, and something may pop into your feed. And they, like a good example of that, we when when Mass Creative did their whole campaign Arts Matter, I went to one of the conventions. I took a picture on Instagram. Here at the event, hashtag Arts Matters. Martha Coakley liked that post. I'm not friends with Martha Coakley, so she was joining the conversation and she was able to see that post. So that's how effective it can be.
And it's also one of those times too when you kind of want to think maybe differently. So maybe Twitter isn't where you're sharing a lot of your images because it's not really meant for that. But one of the nice things about Twitter is because it moves so quickly, people don't get annoyed if you kind of post a lot.
It's true.
So, you know, on Facebook, when you're posting about your gallery opening every day and your friends kind of get annoyed with you and are like, okay, seriously, I know about this. Whereas Twitter, tweet that several times, you know, it's turning over very quickly. So, if you tweet it once in the morning, at lunch, and then in the evening, maybe three totally different audiences who are seeing that information. So you may want to use it for other promotional means, not necessarily to be showcasing your work.
Yeah, maybe take like a really bare minimum approach instead of just using it and tweeting twice. You know, try to get some kernel of a bare minimum identity on those platforms. That way you get a feel for it, you can monitor it. That way, for example, if you are participating in another event somewhere where the establishment or the venue, they already have a very strong Twitter presence, at least they can include you, right? And at least you get a feel for what they're doing, and at least there's some presence there, even if you don't really want to use it that actively, at least, you know.
Yeah, a lot of conferences and events too will have some kind of hashtag for the event.
Right.
So again, it's just kind of another way. If everyone who's going to that conference is probably going to be looking at stuff with that hashtag, so if you're able to kind of get yourself in there, it's free publicity.
Are there any other people who have had a lot of success or something different kind of on Twitter and how you use it?
Not really a question, so if you want to...
A different question. Well, we'll come back. Hold on. Yeah.
Well, I just had a question about censorship, because to my knowledge, Facebook doesn't allow nudity. In fact, there is a lawsuit going on in France right now by an artist who is challenging that, so... Mm-hmm. I understand that Instagram allows it. Is that correct?
I think there was some senator who said what is pornography, and he said, I don't know, but I know it when I see it, type of thing. I think Instagram might be a little bit more in that category, where if it looks like art, it's not going to be as but it's a really good point. I think the nature of art is we're pushing boundaries, pushing envelopes, whatever that happens to be. And if it's, a lot of times you don't know what box you're in until you find the edges of it, if you've invested all this in this platform and all of a sudden, in the future you're want to do something new and you've discovered that all this investment, all of a sudden they're now constraining your identity as an artist, that's not cool, no bueno, but I think it's a balancing act.
Yeah.
Do you know the cases with Twitter?
Again, I think it's sort of, so one thing I think it's important is to kind of look at each, any platform you decide to use, kind of look at their terms of service and what is allowable. Because one of the things that can happen, and I've seen this happen to people, is they kind of build up a great presence and they've got a community going, and then they post something that violates or people feel violates those terms of service, and it can just get their whole account deleted, and then you've lost all that work. So you want to be aware of that. And a lot of the platforms too kind of go on a complaint-based system. So if you put up a nude painting and nobody complains about it, you're fine. But if a bunch of people decide to start flagging it as inappropriate, that's where you may run into trouble. I've seen a lot of artists kind of get around this with, they'll blur or they'll put little stars or you know, almost kind of be sort of funny and sarcastic, you know, put like ridiculous emojis or cartoons over, you know, parts of people's bodies. So, you know, again, it's sort of...
But there is still the web, you know, the web is still pretty open, and that's, you know, especially if, I mean, so there's still the web, and, you know, it's at that point, I mean, the nature of security in general and censorship and all that, it all comes down to, you know, it all just comes down to interest and motivation one way or another, you know, and you can get around stuff, you just might, if you're really doing something edgy, you know, there are ways to... You'll find people that will support you from a technical standpoint. You know, I'm giving a talk at next week in New York City at something called the Blockchain Summit or Blockchain Workshop, and it's all about Bitcoin and censorship-resistant payments and stuff like that. So, you know, I think there are always ways around it, but it's just really more finding the right platform for you as an artist, and that would probably match with your community, and it'll match with your kind of requirements.
And like you said, too, you know, you always have your, you know, if you have your website or whatever, so something fun, you know, you can post like a sliver of a painting and say, you know, hey, go to my website to see, you know, this picture that's too hot for Twitter or too hot for Instagram, and, you know, kind of turn it into something, a positive for you that then drives people back to your website where, you know, like you said, you kind of get more information, more analytical stuff that's probably more valuable to you.
Yeah, generally speaking, the web is going to be much less restrictive. I mean, the web in general, unless it's on like a hosted blogging platform, like a Tumblr, you know, something like that. But generally, like, if you just go and it's not too expensive, but if you just go and get, you know, a friend or something to throw up just a static website, you can, you know, a few $100, $500, you can get something out there that if you're really just wanting to get your stuff out there.
Another question over here.
As related to Instagram, I'm curious to know if either of you has any opinion on kind of how to bridge the gap between creating a curated feed without feeling extremely sterile. Some of my favorite makers on Instagram, their feeds are almost over-curated, and it feels very impersonal and very inauthentic despite the live authentic hashtag. So if you have anything to speak to that, I'd love that.
Yeah, I liked it when people started making fun of the "I woke up like this" hashtag with like the pictures of them with their makeup smeared on their face. Because it's that same thing. So I don't know if you wanna.
Yeah, I guess I don't. I mean, I'm not a. We're just getting into, you know, Instagram to be perfectly blunt. I called up my little brother who's a fashion photographer. He's got 25,000 followers. I was like, please tell me how. We're supposed to use this thing, but I think, you know, there's authenticity and rawness versus...
I mean, do you think there's benefit in breaking it down a little and making it feel a little more friendly?
Yes.
Yeah, probably.
Versus...
Absolutely.
If it's your, especially if it's an individual, if it's just your personal...
I mean, I understand the benefit of a gallery or a particular fine arts person who's strictly selling, but if you're, like, I'm a ceramics maker and I make mugs and bowls that are intended for everyday functional use?
I personally think so. I mean, one of the big revelations for me in being like really deep diving into the art space the past year is just how important the artist is to the art. You know, there's like, I mean, it's less, does this piece of art look good with my curtains or my couch? It's, is this artist awesome? And do I like them? And who are the, who, what makes them tick? Why, you know? And so I think bringing a lot of that personality out, I think is definitely just be yourself, you know. I think that can only help personally. That's my personal take on it. If it's more of an institutional thing, if you're running an organization or something, then probably that's almost by implicitly somewhat more curated.
Cool. Yeah. Yeah, and I would say, like, you know, strike a tone that works for you too. You know, obviously you're going to want to still keep it somewhat professional, but you know, yeah, have some of your personality in there. That's part of your artwork, and I think in general too, people don't want to feel like they're being marketed to. So you know, if you are posting things that sound like a sales pitch or you know, like marketing jargon, people are going to tune that out immediately. So you know, something that at least sounds like a person wrote it is always better.
So kind of on the same note of
having the person behind the accounts actually be behind the accounts and talking to people. I'm curious how you guys start conversations and how do you have good conversations on social media if that's, you know, something that you want to do. Do you guys have any tips on that?
I mean, you can just start out by asking a question. I mean, that's sort of the easiest. People love to share their opinions and thoughts about things. So whether that's, you know, asking them about a work of art, you know, including people in the process, you know, what color should I glaze this bowl or whatever. I think another good way too to kind of keep things interesting and a little fresh is, you know, see how you can kind of tie your work in with things that are going on just, you know, in the world that you'd be sharing on social media anyway. I think a really good example of an account that does this is, I'm gonna laugh, the United States Postal Museum's Twitter account, right? Because when you hear
write
U.S.
Right now,
seriously, you gotta check it out because
it's actually a really cool place. I've been there.
Well, now I really wanna go because I've been following them on Twitter. Like, it doesn't sound like something that would be very cool or interesting, but their Twitter account is great because they kind of, you know, tie in if it's some celebrity's birthday and like there was a stamp of them, they show that, or they, you know, include these kind of cool pieces of postal history that tie in with other significant historical events, and it's way more interesting. And I'm glad to hear it's just as cool as the account because I'm going the next time I'm in DC.
Yeah, the old adage, if you want to be interesting, be interested, you know, that's kind of just, you know, get and explore other people's stuff rather than just being all about it.
And talk within your community too. You can always, you know, kind of help promote each other, tagging each other, sharing each other's events. You know, all that stuff kind of helps open, you know, different artists up to different audiences, and again, also kind of makes you sound like a real person because you're doing the things that people usually do on social media. You know, sharing content that they like and talking about it.
Does Somerville have, like, so when I post stuff, my business Somerville in my name, but I often hashtag Somerville. Is there a hashtag at Somerville Artist, or is something that represents the Somerville community?
And yeah, I was talking about this with actual Daniel Festa from Creative Living Works, and she's been using in some of her work summer arts, and I think it has to be kind of a general consensus for like people to kind of be able to use it. That's a good conversation for folks to have if people want to have a general consensus about what they want to use for some of the arts. I don't know if you have a
usually if I think of, you know, or I'm trying to think of a hashtag for something, I usually just search it and see, like, is it already in use? Is it in use in a way that I'm okay being associated with?
Right.
Sometimes, you know, things can...
It's available, just so you know. Summer Arts. Because Summer Arts was actually from San Francisco. So they said, hey, that's our hashtag. Have you? And they made actually that suggestion.
Summer Art.
Yeah, so I mean, if you just kind of start using it and then other people pick up on it and it takes off.
You can do a really powerful hashtag right here in this room.
Why not
Summer Art?
It's
too long.
Summer Art.
Short for Twitter.
Yeah.
Can you Twitter page?
We could all do that right now.
Is there some way to stake a claim to a hashtag? Because last year there was a problem because several open studios was trying to use SOS 2015, but there were several other organizations using it. How do you claim it as yours? Or you have to be there first? Where was there first?
Yeah, there's no trademarking involved with hashtags. Because you do bring up trademarks,
I'm not talking about trademarks. Is it whoever gets there first is the one who defines what it's going to be?
No,
so
I think
also
it's just whoever
gets there and is the biggest.
Yeah,
too.
Whoever
I
just
mean, you can be there first, but if someone else is flooding it with their stuff, then you are.
Or, for example, if, you know, on those 2 days in May, SOS 15 might have been fine because, you know, it's just if that's what's going on, a bunch of people are going to be using it, so that's going to kind of flood.
Temporarily inhabiting.
Yeah.
What is the hashtag SOS 16 this year?
We
have one. Don't worry. We had that conversation, and this issue comes up all the time. So I do marketing for a nonprofit in healthcare, and we have this problem all the time, where it seems like every time we have a conference, there's also a Christian conference in Canada that's doing this. It's actually happened quite a bit. It's pretty funny. But so this year, to hopefully just quell this a little bit, we're going to do Somerville OS 2016, which is a little longer than I would have ideally liked, but hear me out. So once you start doing it, and once other people start doing it, it's going to autofill it for you, which is one of the things that we're hoping just helps to quell it. There's nothing worse than having like several tweets that are great, and then you have five more that just are completely random and about something else.
And Twitter, that would just take up so many of your...
Yeah, and I was looking through so I can also talk at length about the thought that I put into hashtags, but the reason that we decided to go forward with that one is because Somerville is long, but a lot of the tweets are not long that people are putting out the day of. A lot of times it's site number, it's a picture, it's different things that are happening on Twitter, but also Instagram, kind of like what they've been saying, is it's the biggest one. A lot of people are posting on Instagram, and once you get on there, the world's your oyster. You can have a pretty long hashtag, you can have 20 hashtags, and it's okay. So this is a test.
My brain shuts off when there's too many hashtags. I'm just like,
Somerville OS 2016.
Somerville.
What was the one you were saying?
Summer Art.
Not two M's.
No, I don't know.
Yes.
Really?
Oh.
Yes. I'll put it on the Facebook page, John, okay? Just so everyone's all on the same page.
Sorry.
Okay?
Excuse me. I just didn't hear, was it Summer Art or Summer Arts?
That's exactly singular. What I was just saying.
Summer Art.
One art.
It's no S.
Yeah.
Okay. Summer Art. No S.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So we're getting close, or we're past 7:30, and I want to give, we're 7:45, we're way past it. So I have one last question, and we've kind of already, hopefully, had a few come up, which is great examples, which I know for me is always a really helpful way to figure out what I should be doing. A few of them have come up. If you guys have any more to share, either, if it's platform specific, if it's, they're great artist examples to go and check out. If you guys have any more that you'd want to share, I'd say let's share. And if other, looks like we already have one person who might have a good example.
There's no right answer to this question. You talk about cadence and posting. Mm-hmm. What, if you had to describe like staying relevant, staying active, what does that mean?
So again, it's going to kind of vary by platform a little bit, because again, something like Twitter turns over really quickly. You could be just tweeting constantly and that would be fine. Facebook kind of best practices are like 1 to 2 posts a day from a page. With when you do the, and that's one of those things, again, you kind of play around with, figure out like when are the right times to do that. Instagram seems like Twitter a little more frequently is okay. Facebook's the tricky one, because if you post too much, they kind of think you're spam and they'll like bump you down and no one will see you. So it's kind of finding that good balance of putting enough out that people are seeing you, but not too much that Facebook thinks you're a spam page.
Yeah, I would say that's just about right. Like with, it's, if it's, let's say, a really important event to you and you're in the conversation at that point, Somerville Open Studios, and, you're very active there, doesn't mean you have to keep up that activity level, and that's sort of a burst. And then normally, I would say probably at least once every few days, just something out there to show that you still have a heartbeat type.
Yeah.
Nancy.
And keeping on the Facebook topic, what are the pros and cons of having an artist business page versus a personal page where you promote yourself as an artist?
So many.
Yeah, I would echo that. Facebook pages are definitely much more valuable. They give you much more, many more analytics, and it kind of.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's,
yeah. Yeah, so you can kind of. get more data about the people who are looking at your stuff, where they're coming from, how they're getting there. It allows you to do advertising if that's something that you decide you want to do. It gives you, you could have more people like a page than can friend you as a person on Facebook. And it also allows you to keep your business and personal separate if you want to. Those are, I think, kind of the big advantages of doing the page.
I had a question in the back.
Just a follow-up on that question is, what are your thoughts about Facebook business page versus a web page? Professional web page. There's obviously the cost involved running a web page, whereas Facebook is, unless you go for the advertising route, it's actually free.
That's a really good question. It might be an and versus an or. If you have to choose one, Facebook is definitely faster to get up and running, less cost. It's also a little bit less original, the aesthetic. You know, you're looking at your blue and white page, and it's not really set up. You can't really make it your own. So it's just, it's kind of doesn't look as creative and interesting as your own site would.
But like, for instance, if you're looking for like galleries to view you, would you recommend it's important to have that web page? You know,
yeah.
To sell your work, maybe, or get your work viewed by other galleries?
One tends to be, I mean, Facebook will let you pin posts, but a website is a little bit more static. Like if you wanted to show, a current showing or current, portfolio of some sort, or currently in your, your showing, you do have to also worry about updating a website, which sometimes is not trivial. If somebody doesn't set up something known as a content management system that makes it easy for you to go in and do it yourself, there are systems that, that's something, if you are building a website, it's a conversation to have with whoever's helping you build it, to say, how am I gonna update this? Am I gonna need to call you each time and pay you each time? I just wanna update my images. Making sure you have access to all of the accounts and all the passwords and things like that. If the person, skips town or something, they are the only ones who can update your website. So those are all much bigger considerations with a website than with a Facebook. What's that happen? Yeah.
It's not uncommon. There is a site called Fine Arts Studio Online.
So,
and they have a really nice format for great artists that you can set up categories. They do all the hardware for you to make a web page, and I'm not really good at web pages, but they made it really easy. It's easy to go back and set up, and to sort of, you can do your webmail through it, you can do your domain, everything. I think I pay like $10 a month. Everything's already in one package. It's really nice.
Can you repeat the name?
Yeah, it's faso.com.
It is nice. Awesome. There are a lot of great sites, even some of the blogging platforms, either with a paid account, but they're usually pretty cheap, like $10-$20 a month. That'll give you something. You can at least set something up and have it there. And it'll be easy enough for you to update it. It may not be the best looking thing in the world, but it's something.
Yeah. What sites do you recommend for selling art? Website or art.com kind of has
I think a lot of it depends on the price point. I mean, I think there are places where there are marketplaces where you can sell stuff online. You can use our app, but our app isn't really designed to be a public marketplace. It's designed for a very kind of targeted private commerce, if you will. But I think that really depends on the price point, oftentimes, and who you're trying to reach. Because a lot of marketplaces have built-in communities, Etsy has a huge built-in community that'll help you build. You could do an Amazon web front or web store or something like that. But again, those may not be effective depending on what it is you're trying to sell. I just personally think, online art sales are growing. It's a fast-growing part of the market. If you look at whatever market size numbers matter, it's, the art market is like 60 billion or something like that. The online is 8. So it's growing. Saatchi Online is one. I think they might. There are Paddle Aid. There are various sites that allow you to sell, but your kind of your mileage may vary, I guess.
How do you spell SCATV?
SAATCHI. Paddle Aid is an online marketplace or online auction. I mean, there's eBay. eBay has a partnership with Sotheby's, I believe. I don't know how that works or what that is, but eBay/Sotheby's. But
kind of an addendum to that, Facebook is now allowing you to do some tools to set up a shop on your page. How effective has that been for folks?
Or has
anybody used it?
Yeah. So I initially started with Squarespace, which I think is a great platform for artists. It's a very affordable place to build a website, but since I have a storefront, I moved to Shopify, which makes it much easier than brick and mortar and online commerce. Because Squarespace, you can't do brick and mortar, so if you want to sell in person, you can't do that. But it does link up with Facebook and Pinterest. So I have a storefront on my page. I have to say, I don't find Facebook pages to get much traffic, and I've really looked at other people's Facebook pages, like really popular people, and they also don't get a lot of traffic, but their personal pages get more traffic. I'm more in the craft world, but not the fine art world, but I really am paying attention to this because it's my business, and I'm getting the most traffic from Googling, from word of mouth, and from like personal referrals.
One of the things I have noticed as far as, is because I have a lot of people who are musicians, the subscribe button is kind of like the holy grail to getting people to come to different events and things like that.
What do you mean the subscribe button?
There's a subscribe, you can have people subscribe to your Facebook page.
Right.
And that will, and to encourage people to do that, so anytime you have a craft event, or have a show that's going to pop up. And that's just to let people know automatically, even if they don't know about them and even if they can't see it, then they'll know about it. So that's one of the things that I've
I do post your events and all that stuff, but I haven't gotten that. And it's in every email I send them. That's the one thing I'm very curious about with social media, because truthfully, Instagram is the most visual, and for artists and makers, it seems like the biggest platform. Like I've gotten, if Instagram, for instance, had I could do events, but I think the whole reason that the way it's as popular as it is, because you're only seeing a steady stream of images, it works the best.
Yeah, and that's, you just kind of playing around like that and figuring out, you know, which one works for what you're doing.
Well, if you go look at other people like in your field, like other painters or sculptors or whatever, local and like super famous ones, pick someone like so fabulous and famous and go look and see really how many people are not even just liking their page but commenting on their posts, because that's a real measure of how well that platform works.
That actually makes the post, the more people comment on your post, the more you're going to get traction to that particular post.
And also, if somebody likes your post that on your business page, and you hold your mouse over that, they'll all come up. You can see all their names, and you can invite them to them like the page if they don't already like the page.
Yeah, and I think that speaks to too. I feel like especially on Facebook, but on really all the platforms, it is a lot of work to build up your audience and your community. So kind of being selective about, so like if you're finding that Facebook isn't really working for you, maybe that's one that you don't put a lot of time into because it's just not worth it.
Yeah, and I think one open X factor that I think is maybe, I don't know if there's a really good answer to it, but I would definitely be interested in hearing what people have discovered is around video, right? So, you know, Facebook and all these, I mean, there's certainly YouTube, but even Facebook now is seeing more and more and more video. I don't know how that applies to art, but I think a lot of consumers and end users are really engaging with video content. It's easy for it to go viral and that type of stuff. So, you know, I don't know, maybe it's video that is sort of about exhibitions and stuff like that, where people saying interesting things. I don't know. I haven't necessarily seen it used extremely well, but I think it's something at least to keep an eye on.
Yeah, I think it's
I can say just like one tiny thing about that. There is a ceramicist that lives in Copenhagen, Tortoise Copenhagen, I think he is on Instagram. And in a single year, he's gotten hundreds of thousands of followers, and he strictly posts process videos and some like finished products. But it's like, like this one person in a very nicely shot 15-second video of him throwing a piece of porcelain into a large vase.
That's an awesome point. Process is, we met with the provost of RISD, and they said it's just like all the students, that's all they talk about. That seems, they don't even really care about the market. It's just all about process. I don't know really what that means, but.
if any of you are calligraphers, there's like a huge online community of people who just will watch videos of people doing calligraphy. Like they find it very soothing, right, I guess, or. I forget what the other one I saw like the other day, but stuff like that, like people will just, they'll watch you paint if you put it up.
Pottery spinning.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay, we have a question in the back.
How can we invite people on Instagram to say to an event? Can we like write it on the picture?
Yeah, I've done that.
You can post the photo of the invite, but it's not as powerful.
You can do that. So one of the things that Instagram doesn't, you can't put links in the comments, which is very annoying. What I've seen some people do is if there's, you know, something big coming up that they want to direct people, they change the link in their bio. You are allowed to have a link in your Instagram bio, which most people usually use to just go back to their website or whatever, but like,
I guess depending on it, you could use your own personal calendar. You know, Google Calendar isn't terrible. You could also use Eventbrite, I guess, is one, or you know, other kind of more, you know, event-oriented tools.
Yeah, I would also just give a plug for Facebook events, because if you have a Facebook event and someone is, you know, interested, if they've liked it, if they're attending, it'll show up in their friends' feeds as well. So it's a nice one to use, but. On Instagram itself, I think that's what I, just from practical experience, see the most. Also, videos, sometimes people might do a little plug for an event in videos as well. It's not as easy to kind of get them to more info, but.
One thing I think we would be remiss not to mention is crowdfunding, crowdsourcing, crowdfunding, you know, Kickstarter, things like that. I think earlier on, there were a lot of people using Kickstarter. Like if people visited the Artisans Asylum, you know, I just went to a really awesome seminar of sort or meetup of how to use Kickstarter for those types of projects. Now, I think I heard often earlier on sort of crowdfunding art almost like commission style on Kickstarter, maybe Indiegogo too, started off being much more common, and then there was sort of a fatigue in it. Kind of tapered out, but those are tools, depending on what you're doing, that can be pretty effective, and you know, I think that also is a way to, they've got built-in channels, you know, and they can be expensive to produce the video for that, but if you're trying to put together an event, you know, they have a lot of built-in audience for you know, videos.
I was going to add something that I've been curious about. I'm not in the art world, so I've never had a reason to use it, but does anyone use Patreon?
I just signed up. It was a while ago, and it's difficult. I have like 2 followers.
Yeah. So it's sort of a similar sort of crowdfunding,
right.
Where basically people will sign up and pledge a certain amount. Is it monthly, or?
It can be, or it could be. Product.
Oh, yeah, so per project, and then they usually get some kind of a reward, like, you know, an exclusive file of a piece, or, you know, a thank you from the artist, or you kind of set different rewards, and, But yeah, I've just been curious about that myself, like, if people find that useful, or...
I think they need a book, like, Patreon for Dummies or something. It's... Like everything else you've been describing, you have to figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't had a whole lot of success. I haven't spent a whole lot of time with that. I think they just updated their artist pages so it has a better layout and have a larger banner. So I've added some interesting photography, but creating a whole bio and trying to explain what you do, you know, beyond an artist statement, getting these people that are coming across your page to notice you, to take interest in you, giving you $1 a month or $5 a month or whatever, and figuring out what to give back. That's a value, whether it's something you mail to them or a digital file. One person was suggesting that I take these new photographs that I'm doing and make them into like coloring book art or something. So they would remove all the color and increase the lines. And it was just kind of a stretch, but it was an idea of like, here's something popular, you know, that you could give that's, you know, a little different and might be valuable to someone. I would normally be just sending, you know, postcards or photos or something. But I could offer larger pieces of work, like framed photos, you know, at a discount. That could be a reward for someone, you know, giving me a little money every month. But I don't expect to buy a car or anything.
What is it called again? Patreon?
Patreon. So it's P-A-T-R-E-O-N. And it was started by a famous musician, and it's for, mainly for artists who are turning out music constantly and wanted the feedback and engaging their fan base and to give back to them, and also for people that are creating videos and stuff like that. But there are artists that create comic books or web series. Just about everything is on there.
Yeah, it seems like it works really well for things that have like a comic book or a regular sort of certain format and regularity to them.
So we're a little past 8, and our event goes till 8:30. So I am more than happy if people are liking this format of kind of question and answer. We can keep that going. If people do want to break out into the little breakout groups that we've been talking about, maybe people have a question they're really dying to talk about, want to like throw their hand up and suggest it, and people can come and chat with them. Do people want to keep up with this format, or do we want to move into that? I mean, this is an event for everyone to learn about marketing, so crowdsource this the last half hour.
Crickets.
Yeah, that's okay too. In which case, maybe we just keep the question and answer going.
Yeah, are there any other questions?
Or? Yeah.
I was wondering, do you also do performance acts in your gallery, and how can you like promote performance acts?
That's a good one. We haven't, although the artist is going to paint a drawing live in our space, but I don't, it's kind of weird, it's an office space, so I definitely want to, you know, make a scene, but not too much of a scene. I don't know, I mean, I think, you know, Armory, right, is a great venue. There are definitely venues that I think you could kind of make your own, that are more oriented toward that. You know, I think I think it's more up to the artist, right? What's the right?
Do you know anyone who's providing like organizational support, like grant writing support, or some sort of other stuff for performance artists?
I don't know off the top of my head. I know grant writing in general is really important. A lot of times it's annoying because you have to, you know, to go schmooze with certain people or find out what grants are available, and you know, there are only a certain number, so it's time consuming and there's no guarantee. But it's important. I mean, there are a lot of grants out there, and I
can't choose.
Yeah. Okay.
We, the Central Arts Council, has a grant program. You don't necessarily have to be a simple artist. There's two categories. There's intelligent project grant. The grant season starts in fall, so we start info sessions during September, so you're welcome to go to that. Sign up for our listserv, and you're more than willing to be able to get all the information that you have. The deadline for the grants is always October 15th. If you're looking for additional grants to kind of get you started on what's available, Associated Grant Makers is a wonderful resource. And the database of different grants that are out there. Also, the MCC has fellowship grants that they do in addition to the grants that we provide.
Is he also kind of how to write the grant?
for Ashley on Simple Access Television has had grant writing seminars. So you can also become a member and they can let you go available grant writing. There's also a lot of adult ed programs that also offer grant writing as well, like Cambridge Young Center for Adult Ed, Brookline the Center for Adult Ed, so you can go to those particular workshops. And a lot of times it's only probably like a day or two workshop on how to do different grants.
What was that website you said? Associated
Grant Makers. Yeah, and that's based here in the Boston area.
Well, I know a lot of people have wanted to ask you or kind of direct questions about burglary, so that could be one group that could form if anyone has questions about his platform, or I know you mentioned kind of a demo as well. So.
I'd love to demo it and answer any questions. We're really early on. We have, you know, the four of us, so we're really just listening to the community and having people tell us what they want, and they say jump, we say how high. You know, the trade-off is it's early and, you know, there might be quirks here and there, but we have, you know, it seems like it's quite stable now. We've got a lot of people adopting it, and, you know, so, but it's weird, you know, we're kind of, the art market is really weird, right? It's just a strange market. And so we're kind of exploring it. Different use cases and different users. Like a gallery use case is a little bit different than a studio use case. One of the things we're really focused on is right now we're in the process of importing our first few private collections. And that's interesting because right now the way that the market works in the art market is that typically a gallery is kind of, you know, a firewall against, you know, sort of relationships between the artist and the collector. Oftentimes for good reason, that it's more their relationship than when you buy a piece, you don't necessarily know who bought it, how much they bought it for, when they bought it, you know, hopefully they're ethical and you'll get, you know, they'll honor their consignment agreement, but there's really no disclosure. So we're trying, like when we get paid, the artist gets paid at the same time. So that's one of the things we're doing, and we're also trying in a very you know, kind of careful way to honor privacy, but we're importing private collections, you know, several multi-million dollar collections, whereby, you know, now all of a sudden they're, you know, like when a collector puts the art in the system, any artist who's in that collection, when they log in, they'll see that. It'll just auto-discover. So when you as an artist log in, you'll just see all your pieces that other collectors have already put in, and vice versa. When a collector logs in, you know, if an artist had indicated that this is the collector who purchased it, we're sort of trying to, you know, and it'll say, you know, private collection. When you share your portfolio out, it'll say, oh, this piece is in a private collection. It won't show the name of that collector. So these are the type of things we're looking at. But it's very experimental, so, I mean, we're definitely open to input. You know, we love people. The more people say, we really, you know, we really want you to do this, it really helps. We love it. We'll go do it. Because we don't, I mean, I think anytime you build software in a vacuum, you know, you're not going to be successful. The more you just serve your community and serve, you know, I think the more you're successful. So it's a conversation.
Yeah, so people definitely feel free to target any of those questions. Megan, maybe you're staying around for a little bit. Yeah. I think one thing we weren't able to really go into was kind of those platform-specific best practices. So that seems like a question that's right up your alley. Or any other question that you might have for Megan, maybe, about the city of Somerville. And I don't know, not really, maybe. But
it's too late for that.
And if you're
but I can still talk about Twitter.
Yeah. And if you're sitting by someone that you have a conversation or a topic that you guys are really passionate about, maybe just shout it out and other people can come find you as well. So. Are there any topics that people really want to chat about?
I just want to see the demo.
Okay. Got the demo then.